I saw a James Bond film when I was about 15, and I shouldn't have done because it was certified older than that. Can't remember what it was, but I know it was dead risky for me to try and get in to see a James Bond film. I think it was something like Dr. No or something like that. It's very old. And it, but James Bond was the bee's knees.
For me, I wouldn't care what it's shot in. If I enjoyed the film, no matter whether it's analogue or digital, I mean, I've got really, really favourite films that have, I think Blade Runner was shot analogue. Brilliant film. But Avatar is digital and I love that too. So it, to me, it wouldn't matter what it was shot on, what media, what's important is the film itself and the story and how it's filmed.
2D looks sometimes really weird.
At the time, it looked okay, but when you think back, yes, it was not particularly sharp. Any special effects were, when you compare them to today, they look very sort of toy-like almost, very quite amateurish, some of it.
It makes my eyes hurt sometimes. But it's cool because of it.
You went to see the cinema, there was a supporting film and a main feature. So you would watch a film and then there would be a break. And at the break point, that would be when you would go and buy your drinks and ice creams. But to buy them, usually a lady, used to carry a tray with a round their neck with all the ice creams and drinks on it. And they used to walk down the aisles and stand at the front of the cinema, on the front of the row, and you'd queue up to buy your, you wouldn't go to the kiosk like you do now, you would queue up to buy it from this lady, or man actually, with had everything on a tray. And you'd take your tub of ice cream or your drink back to your seat. That was it. So you didn't actually leave the cinema once you went in there.
I guess it's just nice because I think you sort of feel emotions more than at home because there's more things going around at home. But when you're in cinema, it's just the big screen and your popcorn and your slushy. Okay.
My name is Alfie Green and I run a company called Creative Nerd, which is an agency which specialises in web design, social media and also video editing. Because everything is being filmed digitally these days, I suppose there is that risk that analogue does become something of the past. However, I think that it will become a very limited edition quality, so you will go and see a film at the cinema and you'll go, oh my god, it was filmed in analogue. And it will kind of become, you know, a classic and a way of doing something that isn't the norm.
I'm Oaksy, I'm 23 years old and I work in the Insight and Innovation department. The main purpose and drive of our department is to look at trends across the internet and youth culture and in all sorts of areas of our lives and think about how we can bring big brands and organisations closer to a youth audience. I hope that analogue filming won't become a legend of the past because I think it's very important to preserve and celebrate the modes of and ways of filmmaking that got us to where we are today. I do think that they will be preserved for those who are kind of more culturally and artistically curious rather than kind of just aiming to make a big blockbuster, because I would presume that there's not the same amount of money in analogue that there is in digital, because there is a focus, like I said, on just streamlining every process. So I imagine that it's harder to do and it's harder to justify. But I hope that we would still be able to get that variation so that for those of us that aren't so keen on kind of huge digitally enhanced filmic experiences, we'd be able to have other options.
My name's Ali Ulig, and I work at Latimer. I guess I'm the in-house filmmaker, in-house director, kind of oversee production. and I kind of try and get involved with a lot of the films that are made here. I shoot films and I edit them as well. People are using analogue film less and less. Like I said, it still gets used in feature films in cinema, but in TV, documentary, it's digital. However, there's quite a big world online where you can still buy film, go and get film sent off to be developed. There's a community because people still like shooting on film. Film will always exist. However, I think the question is, how many people will be using it? Will it be a niche thing? Will it be only a couple of people who use it? Or will there be a movement? I think there will always be a movement for film lovers because film is such a beautiful aesthetic. It's such a beautiful thing. Not many things can compare to film. There's no digital camera that can replicate the look of film. So there's always a demand for it. And personally, I'm a big fan of Super 8 film. I shoot a lot of Super 8, and I've discovered Super 8 online, and I ordered my Super 8 camera online. I got my film processed online, and I've put my Super 8 films up online. The digital world is actually enabling the analog world to connect with people who, you know, weren't that familiar with analog things. So, you know, there'll be a whole new generation of film lovers who will find out about film, find out about analog through a digital world, through digital means. So the two can kind of work together in tandem and enable each other.
Salzburg, January 27th, Wolfgang Amadeus is born. 1761, at the age of 5, Amadeus begins composing. 1773, he writes his first piano concerto. 1782, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart marries Constance Weber. 1784, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart becomes a Freemason. 1791, Mozart composes the magic flute. On December 5th of that same year, Mozart dies. 1985, Austrian rock singer Falco records.
So I'm Thea and I work here at Latimer. I'm head of content. I guess I've had quite a long career in mostly television, latterly digital, as a producer director and more lately as a sort of digital content producer.
My name is Tamara Aboud. I am the head of broadcast at Latimer. Before that, I've been an executive producer and a commissioning editor working in TV. So before that, I was a lawyer. So I've had probably about 14 years in TV now. I think Latimer is a very good example of where we are going in terms of digital, because you know, in TV terms, and I can only really speak from my own experience, I inhabit a world now where people just pick up their phone, they pick up camera kit, very sophisticated camera kit, but now that comes in, you know, small compact form. And they go out and they shoot stuff, and within minutes they've edited and uploaded that content. For me, that is the beauty of digital, that it allows you to be fleet of foot, to sort of go off in quite an economic way and shoot high quality content.
Probably what's interesting to think about is when digital first came about in television, which was probably around the early 90s, you know, at the start of sort of digital editing. I'm not sure if I've got that date right, but it was quite an interesting time because we'd all been brought up on tape, and we'd all been brought up to show our paper edits to our head of department or producer before we went in the edit. and you'd have like, right, here's your slot, you've got to edit from this time to this time, you know, come out with a cut at such and such a time of day. So, you know, it was very sort of prescriptive actually in the way we worked, just because things were so expensive actually. And what digital has done is it's made things much cheaper. But in the first few years of that, what they call non-linear editing, which is what you would be familiar with now, you know, editing on a timeline and not on tape, was a skill that many people didn't have. So you would see job adverts that kind of said, you must have experience of non-linear editing. And so we were all sort of scrabbling around trying to get access to Avid Suites, or I think it was Lightworks at that time, you know, to try and get some experience of what this actually was. Because as with all these things, there weren't actually very many edit suites even within Television Centre at that time. Over the 20th century, there were various lines in the sand that kind of changed things really, the Coronation being the obvious one, and my dad actually was a radio engineer on that broadcast, but of course that was one of the first times that television came into the home. And then if you look at other things like the advent of colour, like the advent of the commercial channels in the 1960s, they really changed things. What you see with digital is there are two phases to it. There's the first phase, which was about how we made television, which was all about the craft and all about the sort of practices of making films. But then the second phase is all about the internet and broadband. And it's actually this moment in time now where you've got the ability to post pictures, to even broadcast from your phone live. That's game changing, because what will happen now is you'll see the whole convention around how television is scheduled and actually sort of shared with people will change rapidly. And that's when we really start to get an egalitarian industry that has a range of voices and that people can actually use. So it's almost people power is about to take over, I would say.
Better quality picture, better quality sound. And I think it gives you flexibility in the way that you film. I think, if you like, under Analogue, it was a much more laborious process. And we live in a digital age now, so we live in a world where anybody can pick up a camera now. And so we need to make that process as easy as possible. And the technology is allowing, is facilitating that. All the citizen journalists of the world who are now going out and filming things, all the vloggers who are uploading every minute of every day footage from their lives in some way. So I think the truth is, you know, there's no going back from where we are now. It's digital all the way.
So I think for the future of digital and digital filmmaking, we're likely to find more kind of enhanced and constructed viewing experiences. Personally, I'm not a huge fan of 3D cinema. It gives me a bit of a headache, and I'm not too keen on it. I find it all a bit disorientating. But I can imagine that people are only going to try and take that further, so that our experience, our viewing experience, is enhanced to kind of an all-consuming one, which is, you know, it's exciting. I think I would give it a go, but I'm not sure that I would want that every time that I go to the cinema or when I'm trying to watch a film on telly.
Adding dimensions, I suppose, is the next step, although 3D is becoming more popular. These 4D experiences I'm not sure about, you know, where seats move and they blow things at you and all sorts of stuff. But it seems a bit clunky, really.
I think that lines are getting blurred, so it's kind of hard to necessarily tell what's been designed and what isn't, because, you know, I think the technology is getting so sophisticated, which isn't a virtue that I think we were afforded with analogue. So it's an interesting kind of grey area where fantastic brains will have a lot of room to experiment and deliver new experiences to their audience. I think that it will get more efficient, so any inefficiencies that are currently in place will just get ironed out.
I can only think that the equipment will get smaller and therefore easier to carry around, be less cumbersome, so that filming itself is a lot easier, I would think. Could be wrong.
I've seen a 4D film in somewhere like Alton Towers, where they have a special theatre, you know, where you get wet and they spray things at you and the seats move and all the rest of it. Not been to a cinema to see a 4D film. But like I say, I think that's all a bit technical and a bit clunky. So I don't really know what the... somebody will come up with a really, really good way of increasing, I suppose, your sensory perception of what you're watching, or stimulating your senses in some way or another that we haven't thought of yet. I don't know. It's difficult to say. I think one of the things is that with digital and the technology nowadays, exploring those possibilities is much easier, not easier, but it's easier to do more and more things using technology, I think, you know, to explore different ways of doing things.